Hi everyone, welcome back to the Prophecies of Victor the Budgie, where you can hear real budgies channeling hidden messages from the angels. This channel now includes Mailer and Danny, which are two other budgies I was guardian for as well.
Hi, this is Ryan again. In presentation 2, I talked a little bit about the source of the information we are receiving, quantum reversals, and the relationship this information has to quantum mechanics. In this presentation, I'm going to go into it a little further because I believe there are those out there that need a better understanding. So we know the source was mainly the three budgies that we've been working with over the years. Perhaps some wonder why God would choose budgies to communicate or channel information from the spiritual world. I will try and explain it as clearly as I can. However, miracles are often hard to explain, and if they could be explained, then it would probably not be a miracle.
When you have a little creature such as a budgie that has nothing but love in its heart for people, then you have a pure source and an unhampered connection to God. This connection is in its truest and purest form, and usually much greater than that of humans. I am not saying that there are not humans out there that have the same type of love and truth in their hearts. However, it should be harder to convince people that God and the angels are channeling through those people unless you somehow witnessed it. In some cases, even if we saw it happen, we still may not believe what we witnessed. Many would brush it off as an overactive imagination, or even some kind of elaborate hoax. For example, Ryan has gone to some churches where the minister said that God has told him certain things, but there is really no evidence or proof of it. Should we believe anyone who says that God spoke to them and told them to tell their congregation something? Or should we seek some kind of evidence to back it up and confirm it? Do we accept every holy man's words are coming from God, and how do we know that that person is not a false prophet? Take Warren Jeffs, for example. His followers believed, and some still do believe, that he was speaking for God. Look at the history behind it, and what still goes on now. We should know that there are many terrible things he did in the name of God that truly were evil. So we believe that one should seek the truth by determining if there is some kind of miraculous event that takes place during claims of God speaking to us, so we do not falsely believe in something we shouldn't. So therefore, most of what we will be talking about will be backed up in miraculous ways, and that's up to you whether you want to believe it or not.
Take, for example, our new budgie Simon, who we've had for less than a year. You'll probably hear him in the background of this recording quite often. His interactions with us and other creatures are shining examples of love in its purest form. So far in his life, he has made friends with a dying small bird that fell from a tree and broke its wing. Unfortunately, the injury was too bad and it did not survive, but Simon comforted it during its short stay with us and showed compassion towards its suffering. You could tell he was very upset the next day when the bird was gone. About 2 weeks ago, we got a baby guinea pig, which is now in the same room as Simon. Just yesterday, he had his first encounter with him by flying down to his cage and trying to interact with him. The guinea pig was very nervous in the beginning, but Simon was persistent and leaned over while he was clung to the side of its cage and touched it with his beak on the nose. Within a few minutes, he was down at the bottom of its cage interacting with him. We named the guinea pig Oreo. One of the first things Simon did was pick up a piece of hay that he saw Oreo eat before. He twirled it around in his beak for a while, and then he took it right over to Oreo, lifted his beak, and tried to feed him. He did this more than once, and spent much time with Oreo in his cage that day. If you think about it, it's hard enough making friends with us humans, who are about 1,000 times bigger than they are, and it takes a lot of courage and desire to interact with us. Likewise, a guinea pig has a mass weight of at least 20 times the size of a budgie. And for him to get enough courage to go up to him in the first place, like he did, would be like a human walking up to a dinosaur. So not only are budgies loving, they are extremely brave, and Simon demonstrated he is gifted at sensing the guinea pig was not going to hurt him. It is also probable that there is already some kind of hidden communication going on between them that allows them to trust each other so quickly. Today, Simon has already visited Oreo many times and waits for him to come out so he can get as close to his new friend as possible. He even preens him and eats with him, trying some of the vegetables that he has refused to eat before. I'm sure his bond will only deepen in the future, and Simon may even teach Oreo a thing or two. In this next part, I'd like to discuss how the quantum world and reverse speech are metaphysically connected. If we do a little research in quantum mechanics, we can have a basic understanding of some of the weird and seemingly impossible things that happen in the quantum world. In reality, all things created by God or a higher power have atoms and particles that highly resemble universes within them. Even scientists are beginning to agree that multiverses do exist. As it goes, Einstein's theory of relativity and Werner Heisenberg's, Max Born, and Pascual Jordan's theories of quantum mechanics differ from Einstein's findings, and that is what makes it so hard to comprehend. Even though they have contradicting laws, modern science openly searches for similarities between the quantum and cosmos worlds to discover secrets of the universe. Here are some of the basics of quantum mechanics. Both living matter and lifeless matter function under the same laws of quantum mechanics. The laws of quantum mechanics include that when we look further down into the smaller realm of atoms and subatomic particles, the laws are much different than they are in our physical reality. In relationship, a small budgie weighing 40 grams weighs about 2,000 times less than a 150-pound human. So that could mean they are much closer to functioning according to the laws of quantum mechanics than a human would be, and they can see, hear, and sense things that we as humans cannot. I propose this relationship allows them to understand the laws naturally. It's a widely accepted fact that birds have a sixth sense and have basic survival skills that come to them naturally from their understanding of Mother Nature. We believe quantum mechanics is the force that drives Mother Nature. So, if we can believe that quantum mechanics is the driving force behind all life and matter, and there are so many incredible and amazing things that happen along with it, then what is the driving force of quantum mechanics? As we go deeper and learn more, we will find evidence of the true spirituality of God and how it is the next level that connects everything in limited, magical, and miraculous ways. Even though all living cells are powered by quantum mechanics, our understanding of it is obscured by the reality we live in. We are made up of cells, which are the smallest units of life and the building blocks of all organisms. A cell is made up of many parts and often referred to as operating like a mini city, which has many functions. The cell only allows certain molecules to go in and out of it. The nucleus of the cell functions as a control center for the cell and holds the genetic information. It instructs the cell what to do. Mitochondria functions as the power center for the cell to perform what it has to do, almost like a power plant providing energy. Ribosomes are like factories which basically transmit or translate the genetic energy into usable protein molecules. Proteins are the workers of the cells. There is even part of it that packages information and transports proteins on a highway type of structure and a trash dump in the cell that accumulates all the waste. It's widely known that DNA carries an incredible amount of information, and if you had one drop of blood, the information it contains would be similar to having a stack of books which reached from the Earth to the Moon. At the quantum level, it has 23 pairs of chromosomes packed into a nucleus within a cell. DNA controls the form of every living thing. It is self-replicating and self-repairing. DNA intertwines and forms a double helix and often looks similar to a wave if you laid it out flat. Almost 40 years ago, I was amazed when I found out that an atom resembles a solar system with a nucleus or sun in the middle and tiny planets, electrons rotating around them in a fixed orbit. Strangely, scientists found that if you heated an atom, the orbits of the electrons became agitated and they would leap instantly from one orbit to another like there was no space in between. That would be like the Earth jumping from its orbit to Jupiter's orbit instantly. Often they would find that they could actually be in both orbits at the same time until the actual leap took place, almost like they were self-replicating and then moved. So this is just one of the properties of quantum mechanics that does not live in the same reality as we experience in the physical world. One of the weirdest qualities of quantum mechanics, and this is where it gets interesting, if two particles, electrons, protons, etc., are close enough together, their properties can become linked and they are entangled. As a result, they will begin to act the same. The difference being, one would move in a clockwise direction and the other in a counterclockwise direction, or in reverse of the other. Even when you separate them, no matter what distance they are apart, they will still act the same and move in an opposite direction, as if one knows what the other is doing. If you interact with one particle and change its direction, the other will change at exactly the same time, with no known connective properties in between. Einstein called this spooky action at a distance, and even he had trouble wrapping his head around it. Another law in quantum mechanics is one that is highly interesting and explains much of what happens to the recorded wave files that I work with. Scientists have found that often particles, which are solid matter, will act like wave patterns, and wave patterns will often act like particles. Some even act like both wave and particles at the same time. Sound is produced by vibrations and are invisible forms of energy that can penetrate through substances that transfer from particles to particles. Even emotions can cause vibrations and cause wave patterns within the human body. And emotions can directly affect the structure of DNA. Similar to sound, light waves are the electromagnetic waves with slightly different frequencies that produce different colors. Both possess similar properties and yet have many different properties as well. Similarly, sound and light have many different frequencies that we cannot see or hear, but light is often obstructed by solid objects and sound can mostly move through or around them. The most famous experiment to do with the movement of electrons was called the double slit experiment. In it, scientists created a wall with two small slits in it and shot electrons at it. They suspected that the electrons would land and go through the slits directly behind them in the slit areas. However, they found that there were electron hits in places behind the wall where there should not have been, and time after time, the result remained the same, showing that the electrons were moving in a wave-type pattern and could combine or even cancel each other out like a wave of water. The peaks and valleys of the wave pattern created a series of strips, which is known as the interference pattern. Something else that is peculiar is a probability wave. It was discovered that the size of the wave in any location predicted the likelihood of the electron being found there. However, where the wave was big did not mean that most of the electrons were there, but where the electron was most likely to be. The location of the electron itself seemed to be in a jumble of locations. If you do not actually know where the electron is, you can calculate the likelihood of where it would be in any particular space and time. So using the probability wave equation, they can predict with great certainty that 33.1% of the time it will end up in one spot and 7.9% it will end up in another, etc. For me, this becomes quite interesting as I've been working and looking at wave patterns for many years and analyzing the information that has passed through them. Often it seemed to me that when I heard it in one location, it was not necessarily what I heard in the same location the next time I analyzed it. Sometimes it would change, and I could not figure out why. This law can also affect the translations, as you will find that some words are very hard to understand, and there were times that I had to use the probability factor to determine what was being said by the Budgies. This is similar to the way some scientists have deciphered the Dead Sea Scrolls when they found parts of the parchment missing. Try to remember that even though I was listening to recorded messages, the waves were still projected into my ears, and they carried electrons that had an impact on what we were hearing. The final law of quantum mechanics that I'd like to talk about today is probably my favorite. The act of observation says that before you measure a particle at the quantum level, its characteristics are uncertain. For example, in the double slit experiment, it showed that before these particles were observed, they could almost have been anywhere until the moment you observed it. At that point, the uncertainty disappeared. So, the actual measurement of a particle forces it to select how it will act. In other words, the nature of reality is a little bit fuzzy until it is observed and it stabilizes. It is speculated that perhaps our thoughts have an ability to change how particles react and form patterns. The result may also depend on the amount of passion and time one puts into observing things at the quantum level. Over the past 20 years or so, I have spent thousands of hours listening to and observing wave files. To me, I find that it is quite interesting that no one else has discovered the hidden messages that are in Budgie speech in both forward and reverse to the extent that I have. In relationship, those that do experiments in quantum physics use similar measuring techniques that you'd be able to see while viewing a wave file in an audio program. Once the wave file is split in reverse, the reverse particles may be taking on similar properties as they do in entanglement. And that is why we can hear recognizable speech in reverse, which relates to what the Budgies are saying in forward mode. All the uncertainty and fuzziness in the quantum world seem to vanish as things increase in size. At this point, I'm not going to get into alternate planes of existence and parallel worlds. I need more convincing evidence of that, and perhaps I'll find out more as my research progresses. Keep in mind that all this research in Budgie speech was done prior to my knowledge of quantum mechanics. I am not an expert by any means, but I do see many similarities which relate to the quantum world. I have not fashioned the research to support quantum mechanics, but I have looked for scientific information to support the research I have been doing. Therefore, there will be many instances in the recordings that will not even be mentioned or extrapolated on in relationship to quantum mechanics. However, both Victor and Mailer spoke of many of these theories I have only recently discovered myself. As we move forward in these presentations, we will need to discover more similarities and make further observations or even corrections as things evolve. You may have noticed that I'm talking a little funny in this presentation. Sorry about that, but I recently had some dental work done and I'm having difficulty pronouncing some words properly. In presentation 2, I said that I'd be going over The Spiritual Body by Victor, which is another quantum reversal. It's only about 3 minutes long, so bear with me and enjoy.
I'm Look at me, Victor. Look at me. What are you doing under there? I knew what you are. You an actor on the TV? You want to be an actor? You're happy, are you? What are you happy about?
Seeing yourself in the TV, is that why you're happy, Victor?
Where's Betty?
This completes this presentation. If you like what you see, please subscribe to our new Sentinels of the Future channel, which has all the latest presentations in one place, or visit our website at theangelscrolls.com.